Ladies and gentlemen, please be so kind and take your seats. The session will resume shortly. Thank you.
Thank you. Who did this? Whom can we congratulate? Did you watch this? The video?
Yeah.
Fantastic idea, eh? Whom can we congratulate for this? Nobody taking responsibility? Now that I've said it's good, many fathers normally of success. Mr. Schmidt, you are responsible for this? Now, Mr. Schmidt is claiming responsibility for this.
I would like to ask, as an IOC member, on a form of a pen drive, could we get all these beautiful films, whenever we have some lesson or whatever activities in concerning the Olympic movement at home? Is it possible for the IOC members to get these beautiful films?
On the Olympic Channel.
Now, if he has spoken, I don't dare to intervene anymore. Okay, I propose we move to point 13. These are the amendments to the Olympic Charter. And there, Mr. Coates, in his capacity as the chair of our legal commission, will report.
Thank you, Mr. President. Dear colleagues, these proposed amendments to the Olympic Charter have been circulated in advance, the 30 days in advance, and I'll just take you through them. The first one, the addition to the mission and role of the IOC, the addition of the words to promote safe sport and the protection of athletes from all forms of harassment and abuse, was a recommendation from Prince Faisal. And the committee of his, and this was raised at our session in Lima, and they're the words, which I think are straightforward.
Can we approve? Yes. Approved. Any opposition? Thank you. Approved. With one opposition of Mr. Blick. Huh? No? But you raised your hand when I asked for opposition. No. If it's no speech, just. Mr. Coates.
The next amendment is to improve the language, make it a little bit more modern, of the oath that we take when we join, This our communications department, Mr. Adams, and the executive board have all looked at this, and I think it's very straightforward. I hope that's okay, Mr. President.
Give the members, because this is a traditional protocol issue, so we should give the members a moment to reread it. I'm sure they have learned the text, the new text, by heart in their preparations, but.
Would you like me to give the oath again? No.
Are there questions to this text? No? Can we then approve? Okay, thank you very much. Approved. Mr. Coates.
We were requested by the Executive Board to give some discretion to the Executive Board in the case of a member who changes his domicile to another country, to give the Executive Board to take into consider the ability to take into consideration all relevant individual circumstances. It could be financial, it could be political, whatever, but it just gives that discretion to the Executive Board, and I think it's very reasonable.
Thank you. Questions to this? Mrs. Cochuango.
If an IOC member who is an IOC representative to that original country leaves the country, then presumably the country that he or she is leaving will not have an IOC representative? Is that how it would work? Just wondering.
Yeah, on the basis
that... Wait. She is not the only one. Mr. Parsons.
Is this only for individual members or member? Yes? Okay. So that is answered.
Okay. Mr. Coates.
Yes, the effect that someone is still the member in a country but not living there for certain reasons, if that's seen as a problem, that would be, you know, in terms of succession, then that's a matter that the executive board should take into account and consider. But we're giving the executive board the ability to make a decision after taking into consideration all relevant individual circumstances. Yeah.
Thank you. Can we... Mr. Stefan Holm.
Thank you, Mr. President. It might be the language barrier here, but shall cease to be a member if he has transferred his domicile or main centre. Does it only appear to men?
You have to read the very beginning of the Olympic Charter, that he, when used in the Charter, means always also she. Sorry, but this was still the former chairman of the Legal Commission speaking. Sorry. can we then approve? Okay. Any opposition? No? Then approved. Mr. Coates.
Then the clause on resources, there was some discussion on this in Lima. I think you and Mr. Pound in particular thought that we should add, whether you were specific and said we should add donations as well as bequests. Bequests tends to be a testamentary device, I think, and donations is probably a device, is probably a more likely description of what might happen. There was also discussion in Lima that the whole clause needs some review, and that's on a task at some stage. We're just trying to keep the amendments minimal at this stage, Mr. President, sir.
Thank you. Questions? No. Can we then approve? Okay. Thank you. Any opposition? No. Thank you, Mr. Coates.
The last amendment proposed is to Rule 40. And I think the membership, many of you would understand that there's been a fair bit of discussion about the way Rule 40 is interpreted and the way it's presented. And the feeling is that presenting it as we have in the past is really a negative. We weren't doing justice to the what is allowed and to athletes and what is provided to them by way of support. And so this was really to put the bylaw to Rule 40 itself in a positive light. And then you should know that the Executive Board has adopted new principles that sit alongside this rule. It's the Executive Board that adopts their principles. They used to be called guidelines. They did that last week, and my understanding from Mr. McLeod is that they will be sent out to the National Olympic Committees within a week. So when you get those, you perhaps will better understand this, but this is really just presenting it in a positive light so that we can make it clear that we are allowing certain things rather than just presenting this as a negative.
Thank you, Mr. Coates. Questions? Mr. Pound.
Mr. President, I'm just wondering if we're not changing deck chairs on the Titanic here. Have we run this by the athlete groups that have been pressing for a change to this? Because there's no change in what's permitted or not permitted. And have the principles been determined by the executive board yet?
Yes, Mr. Pound. There's discussions at the athletes' forum. There's been discussions with the IOC and the German athletes who negotiated additional changes. There's been discussions between the IOC and the competition authorities in Europe, and there's a strong feeling that the new principles that have been drafted and approved last week are much more liberal than the guidelines have been in the past, but ITMS was involved and they were satisfied. The drafts were run past the NOCs of Europe. Other ones have seen them. I think from your country, Mike Chambers has seen them. So there has been a strong discussion, and I think there are concessions that have been made that we can live with, is the view of our marketing people.
Thank you, Mr. Coates. Further questions? No. Can we then approve? Thank you. Any opposition? No. Then approved. Congratulations, Mr. Coates. Your second unanimous vote today. It's getting a little bit too much. When you come back next, we may have to have some discussions then.
Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And thank you also to all the members of our legal commission for this thorough work. Thank you. And we move on to point 9 of the agenda, please. This is the host city of the IOC session 2021. According to the regulations and instructions you have approved there in 2016, then the IOC Executive Board has been studying potential candidates to host the IOC session 2021. There was a discussion with a number of NOCs, but finally the executive board is coming to the IOC session today with a proposal for Greece. And there I would, before then, you will have the opportunity to discuss this proposal and then to take the decision. I would like to invite the delegation from Greece, led by the President of the National Olympic Committee, Mr. Spiros Kapralos, to make their presentation. Welcome. Congratulations, Mr. Tsivanidis. So, Mr. Kapralos, if you would please introduce your delegation. Of course, our friend and colleague, honorary member Lampus Nicolaou, needs no further introduction, so we welcome him very warmly here on stage together with Mr. Capralos and the Greek delegation. Mr. Capralos.
Dear Mr. President, dear Mr. Honorary President, dear IOC members, respecting your time and because it has been going late and because we have also some very important decisions tonight, I'll introduce very quickly our team and will make the presentation very brief. Mr. Lambis Nicolaou, very well known to you, IOC Honorary Member. Mr. Manolis Kolymbadis, Secretary General of the Hellenic Olympic Committee and former table tennis athlete. Mr. Pavlos Kayalis, Olympic medalist and European champion in sailing. And Mrs. Alexandra Grispou, project manager of the Athens 2021 candidature. And without more words, would like to present you a video message from the newly elected mayor of Athens, Mr. Bakoyannis.
Dear President Bach, dear members of the IOC, ladies and gentlemen, it is a privilege and a pleasure to address you today in my capacity as mayor-elect of Athens. And I would like to very much thank you for giving me the opportunity to second the motion for the city of Athens to host your annual session in 2021. I'm sure many of you have fond memories of Athens. Back in 2004, the Olympic Games returned to their birthplace. It was a momentous occasion, not only for all of us Greeks, but for the whole of the Olympic family. Ever since, we have faced a number of challenges, and yet we have been able to overcome all obstacles, to overcome all difficulties. As I speak, Athens is a lively, vibrant city with excellent infrastructure and the capacity to host mega events of all types. And we hope that you will give us the opportunity to share this experience with you. We hope that you will have the opportunity to visit Athens, enjoy the sights, and at the same time feel part of a city that is constantly evolving and constantly changing. To a great extent, because of its human capital and its human talent. I'm looking forward to seeing you in 2 years, and I do hope that you'll make the decision today. Thank you very much.
Dear President of the International Olympic Committee, dear IOC members, I'm very honored to present at the IOC session in Lausanne. As an Olympic medalist in Rio in sailing and representing the athletes of Hellenic Olympic Committee, I'm delighted to be part of the Greek delegation. We, the Greek athletes, have the Olympism in our hearts. We will be honored to welcome IOC back in our country after the memorable Olympic Games of Athens 2004. We look forward to welcoming you in the birthplace of Olympic Games. Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Greece. Athens. The city of Parthenon. The junction of philosophy, democracy, ancient drama, and modernity. Where sea and sun meet Greek gastronomy and amazing neighborhoods. The city of the Acropolis Museum, of Kalimamara Stadium, of Zapion Exhibition Hall, of Herod's Articus Theatre, and of Benchmark Cultural Centres. Combining the Olympic Games and the classic authentic marathon, Athens is a majestic clash of past and present. A safe city and one of the top 20 European destinations for meetings, incentives, conferences and exhibitions. Athens is a city of high-standard sporting facilities available for prestigious international events. from top-notch football and basketball to golf. CEF, the Peace and Friendship Stadium on the coastal zone of Athens. The home to EuroLeague team Olympiakos and the central venue of the Phalerae Coastal Zone Olympic Complex. It hosted the indoor volleyball tournament during the 2004 Summer Olympics. Ancient Olympia. The birthplace of ancient Olympic Games with a unique in the world archaeological site, the gymnasium, the palestra, the Philippian, the workshop of Idias, where the gold and ivory statue of Zeus was built, the temples of Zeus and Hera, the altar where the Olympic torch is lit for the modern Olympic Games in the ancient stadium. The International Olympic Academy premises in the center of the ancient Olympia is where the Olympic Games and the Olympism life philosophy were born and developed.
And now, let's go to the real business. The session will take place in June of 2021 in Athens. We will start with the IOC Executive Board that we are going to host in the headquarters of the Hellenic Olympic Committee, fully equipped with also an auditorium to have the press conferences for the IOC Executive Board. Okay. Opening session. The opening of the session, we follow the new norms of the IOC. We are not constructing a new venue, but we're going to use the venue of the 1896 Olympic Games in Athens, the old stadium, which can host up to 60,000 people. But it's a beautiful venue, and we think that you'll enjoy being where the modern Olympic Games took place. Then, the session. We are going to use one of the venues that were utilized for the Athens Olympic Games, the venue that hosted indoor volleyball in Piraeus by the seaside. And this is a quite large facility which can facilitate and have lots of different places to put all the requirements during the session. Finally, where you will be staying. We have selected three hotels that are all in one avenue. And from those hotels, you can go to the session or to the opening of the session in less than 10 minutes' time. I think that's very important for all of you. And I think that covers all the parts of the session. But we have something special for that session. We intend to fly all the IOC members to ancient Olympia, birthplace of the Olympic Games, and to have the possibility to take you on a tour to the old stadium and also to the premises of the International Olympic Academy, where a lot of educational and cultural work is being done about the Olympic Games. I think it will be a unique opportunity for everybody to go on this one-day trip to Olympia and experience the magic of Olympia. That concludes my presentation, but I would like to invite you to watch also a message of the first person, the President of the Greek Republic, Mr. Prokopios Pavlopoulos, who is also showing the support of all Greeks to host a session in 2021.
Sir President Bach, Sir Member of the Committee International Olympic, chers membres de la session, c'est avec grand plaisir et honneur que je m'adresse à vous à l'occasion de la demande du Comité olympique hellénique afin que votre session de 2021 se déroule à Athènes. Cette année-là coïncide avec la commémoration des 200 ans de la création de l'État grec et de ce fait, l'organisation d'un événement d'une si grande ampleur et importance dans notre pays, lieu de naissance de l'olympisme, acquiert une importance symbolique particulière. La ville d'Athènes, ville célèbre dans le monde entier comme le berceau de la démocratie, qui a institué les fondements de la civilisation occidentale, lieu de renaissance des Jeux olympiques modernes et lieu d'organisation des Jeux olympiques de 2004, sera prête à accueillir la famille olympique en juin 2021. Je suis sûr que le Comité olympique hellénique, la mairie d'Athènes, ainsi que toutes les autorités impliquées vont coopérer de la manière la plus efficace afin que la session de juin 2021, durant laquelle le nouveau président du Comité international olympique sera nommé, soit couronné d'un succès absolu. Au revoir à Athènes.
Mr. President, this concludes the Athens team presentation. Thank you very much, and we hope you'll give us the opportunity to host you in Athens on 2021. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kapralos. And now I hand over to Mr. Siamyang Eng, the chair of the Evaluation Commission for IOC Sessions, who is performing this task together with our colleague and friend, Mr. Kaltschmidt. Mr. Eng.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is really a Greek moment. Honorary President, dear colleagues, Mr. Willy Kaltschmidt and I are happy to present our evaluation report. And we want to thank Mr. Panos Zvanidis and his team for his support. Congratulations to Mr. Spiro Kapralos and his team for this very excellent and comprehensive report. Thank you also for your hospitality and your close collaboration during our visit. The Evaluation Commission has visited Athens on 6th to 7th of May, and we have confirmed that Athens has all the feasibility to host the session. And we have also managed to confirm and finalize venues for both the opening of the session as well as the session itself, the hotels, accommodations, and other logistics arrangements are also confirmed. On the 22nd of May, EB has accepted and approved the report, and we're now coming to the session for your approval. It is concluded that Athens has met all the requirements necessary to host a successful session, with room rates confirmed for and guaranteed for 2021. And it will be indeed a very inspiring and amazing experience to have the opening of the session at Panathinaik Stadium. And as also indicated, the HOC has also confirmed its close collaboration that they would work to host this session together with the IOC. Having the session in Athens also gave us an opportunity. As President, your wish is that every member should visit Ancient Olympia. So a little correction to Mr. Capreros, IOC will arrange a charter flight and fly everybody there and back on the same day. So to relieve you of your financial obligation. So thank Mr. President, this concludes our report.
Thank you very much, Mr. Eng. Are there questions? No, I don't see any. Then I think I do not need to explain in detail what the reasons for the executive board were there to make this proposal. I think it's highly symbolic. The opening on Olympic Day, 23rd of June, in the stadium, in the Panathinaikos Stadium, the stadium of the first games of the modern era, and then to give at the end of the session every member the opportunity to visit ancient Olympia, something everybody who loves sport should have seen and should have been there. So I think it will not only be from the organizational point of view, but also from the symbolic point of view, a very good choice. Do you agree with this choice? Then please raise your hand. Thank you. anybody who does not want to go to Greece? Okay, thank you very much. Congratulations, Mr. Kavralos and your team. And we are looking forward to the pleasure of seeing you before, but then coming to Greece in 2021. Now I propose we move to 14, anti-doping. And there I would like to invite first of all the chair of the World Anti-Doping Agency, Sir Greg Reedy, to give his report.
Mr. President, Honorary President, dear colleagues, thank you for the opportunity to report to you today. As always, I am joined by our Director General, Olivier Nigli, and we will, I hope, be able to handle any of the technical questions you may have. There is an extensive report on the activities that WADA has been engaged in since I last spoke to you in Buenos Aires. And it is in your documents. That paper has been circulated, and I would like to highlight only one or two key developments. The Russian doping crisis has taken a step, in fact a few steps, in the right direction since last year, and I will deal with that in a moment. This saga, as you know, has been very challenging for sport, but as was mentioned by Mr. Lalovic this morning, crises frequently provide an opportunity to learn and to adapt. The world has changed and the anti-doping system has evolved. It's evolved significantly in the past 4 years and it must continue to evolve, not just inside WADA, but at all levels of the system. If we move to the Russian area, there we go. Following the September 2018 Executive Committee decision to reinstate the Russian Anti-Doping Agency as compliant with the World Anti-Doping Code, subject to some strict conditions, on 10th January, WADA's Intelligence and Investigations Department accessed the non-accredited Moscow laboratory and retrieved the analytical data from the Laboratory Information Management System. 24 terabytes of information were uploaded forensically, indexed and paired to the various instruments, servers, hard drives, computers, and other lab equipment. 24 terabytes, apparently, is equivalent to more than 400,000 hours of music, or the space available in about 5,200 DVDs. WADA's experts, with the support of external forensic experts, are assessing the data in more detail to ensure it is complete and authentic. And in April this year, WADA returned to Moscow and to the laboratory and successfully retrieved 2,262 samples. And these samples could be used to strengthen any cases and to build cases against those athletes who have cheated. We are now in the process of packaging the available evidence for each case, and we will share that with the relevant international federations. Given the large volume of data involved, IFs will only be approached with the data for cases that have been identified as suspicious. In the very near future, we hope to provide more than 100 files to the relevant IFs in the first wave of strong cases against those we suspect of cheating. but it is estimated that by the end of 2019, all priority cases will have been investigated and handed over for results management. If international federations or other anti-doping organizations decide not to proceed, WADA's legal department will review that decision, having in mind that WADA has the right of appeal to the Court of Arbitration for Sport. So I think, as you can appreciate, with the volume of work to be done, significant progress continues to be made on what has been a difficult and highly complex situation. Now, if we turn now to governance, in November 2018, the WADA board approved wide-ranging reforms to WADA's governance structure, which includes, at a future date, an independent president and vice president. This will come into play after the next rotation of WADA presidency between sport and the public authorities. And that will run for the next period. And thereafter, the standards will insist on an independent president and vice president. We're forming a nominations committee to ensure that the right people in terms of skills and independence serve in senior government roles within WADA. We intend to add two independent seats with full voting rights to the executive committee. Nominations for these positions can be made by the sports movement and by governments, but the candidate should have no link to either group in accordance with the strict independence criteria, and that will be vetted by the Nominations Commission. There will be a limit of 3 3-year terms for members of the board, the executive and standing committees. We intend to establish an independent ethics board to ensure compliance with the standards of conduct required for good governance. We intend to make one seat at a minimum available for an athlete and for a national anti-doping organisation on each of our standing committees. As regards additional athlete representation, the voices of the athletes should be further strengthened when there is a mechanism to ensure sufficient representation. Once the athletes are able to confirm exactly how and by what means they are represented, as well as how their representatives are selected, then an open discussion will be held to determine at which existing or new levels within the wider structures athlete representation will be strengthened. Our WADA Athlete Committee has initiated a working group to study this, to look for global representation, much of which fits with the report from the Athlete Forum already given this morning, Mr. President, and WADA management will be supporting these efforts. These reforms are part of a comprehensive review that began when we appointed the governance working group way back in November 2016. They will make a significant difference to how the agency is run. And let me deal with compliance. We have made and tried to make of late real improvements around compliance monitoring. Many of the international federations in this room will be aware of this firsthand. Since our last session in October 2018, WADA has audited 12 international federations and national anti-doping organizations and planned to do another 14 before the end of 2019. An original compliance questionnaire, 307 of them were completed, created evidence of corrective actions that were required. And would you believe that 10,457 corrective actions were identified and best practice recommendations are included in any of these corrective action reports? While they're not mandatory to implement, we strongly recommend that signatories also implement these recommendations to further enhance the quality of their anti-doping programme. And it's pretty impressive that each and every Tier 1 signatory has completed all of their critical and high priority corrective actions, while 99% of the Tier 2 signatures have done the same. And this accounts for the most successful national anti-doping organisations based on their country's results at recent major events, plus all the Olympic and Paralympic international federations. This global improvement has been reinforced by the initiatives of a number of signatories that took the opportunity of this compliance monitoring exercise to conduct a thorough introspection of their anti-doping programs and subsequently restructure their own anti-doping arrangements or processes to improve the effectiveness of the whole process. And this kind of proactive approach is to be commended, and it demonstrates the great level of commitment that we are experiencing. The monitoring system develops and is extensive. It reports to our compliance review committee, and it has been responsible for a major improvement in the quality of the delivery of the processes that are required. And we have also been helped by the work of the International Testing Agency, which has enabled some international federations to remain compliant by taking over the operation of their anti-doping programs. One of the major exercises that has to be conducted once every 6 years is to review and develop the international codes, the World Anti-Doping Code, and the international standards framework. And this was the primary focus of our annual symposium here in this very building in March this year. And since my most recent update, the second draft of the revised code was submitted to our organisation in November 2018 and has then been circulated yet again between December 2018 and March of this year for a third and final consultation process. We have again received numerous comments highlighting the great interest from stakeholders. The recent consultation, we've had 615 comments, 66 official submissions, 16 from the sport movement, 34 from national anti-doping organisations and public authorities, and 16 from other parties. This has resulted in a total of 200 pages of high quality work for the code drafting team to review and to include or not in the final document. And interestingly, since the start of this whole process, 1,995 comments have been received from 211 submissions, and there have been no fewer than 58 individual meetings with stakeholders to get this done. And this gives you some idea of the state, the amount of work undertaken. In parallel, the Athlete Committee is developing an ongoing Charter of Athletes' Rights, and most elements of the Charter reflect rights that are already contained in the Code, while others are more aspirational, with athletes hoping that anti-doping organisations will adopt them as best practice. And all of this will be the main subject of the World Anti-Doping Conference, and that will be held in Katowice in Poland in November this year. In addition to the code, there are the international standards. There's a list of the seven that are involved. The one that is missing is the prohibited list, but that's not part of the review process, as it is reviewed annually via a separate stakeholder consultation. Each of these standards has had a separate dedicated drafting team comprising senior WADA management and external experts so that the standard can be reviewed at the same time as the main code. And this is a very high priority project for WADA. Kirsty, could you pour me a small glass of water only? Right, one of the next projects we have underway is a revision of the ADAMS system, the Anti-Doping Administration and Management System. Complete overhaul has taken place, called the Next Generation, because it's really important that we have a user-friendly state-of-the-art system, which is an essential part of the protection of clean sport. This new system will include enhanced security, improved performance and reliability, and a more intuitive design and functionality. The new Athlete Central Whereabouts application has been built through athlete engagement and feedback. And no one denies that for athletes, providing their whereabouts is a complicated exercise and can sometimes be annoying and time-consuming. We hope these improvements will make it much easier and efficient for athletes to fulfil their obligations under the code. It is undergoing final testing at the moment, and we hope to deliver it in the third quarter of this year. We're also looking at a new paperless anti-doping project, and there are revisions planned for the athlete biological passport system and TUE models. Now, Mr. President, we have the next slide is a sort of rough description of what we regard as some of the more important issues we're dealing with. But in the interest of time, it is in your folder, and I would like to finish this presentation just with a look at the future. I would like to congratulate the next president and vice president of the organisation, Minister Witold Banka, who was nominated on the 14th of May by the public authorities to be the next WADA president, and to Yang Yang, our former colleague, who on the 22nd of May won the sport movement nomination for the position of vice president. I know that Yang Yang has just left, but I believe that Minister Banka is with us in the room somewhere. There he is. Stand up, Minister Banka, who will become rather more busy. These two are the sole candidates for those positions, and they will be elected during the World Conference in Katowice from the 5th to the 7th of November, and take up their mandates on the 1st of January 2020, and I wish them every possible success. I have to say, I think it's rather significant that both Witold and Yang Yang are former athletes at the elite level. So I have no doubt at all that the voice of athletes will continue to be heard as WADA maintains its commitment to protect clean sport and the athletes it serves. In fact, it's now fair to say that athletes will be at the very centre of the organisation going forward. Mr. President, I've gone through this as quickly as I can in the interests of everybody's time, but we'll be very happy to take any questions that my colleagues may have.
Thank you very much, Sir Craig, for your precise but nevertheless comprehensive report. I open the floor for questions to Sir Craig. Mrs. Randall.
Thank you, President, and thank you, IOC members. I have a quick question about the audit that are being conducted with the IFs and the NATOs. Is that something that those audits will be conducted on an annual basis, semi-annual basis? What's the timeline for how often those will be conducted? And will the results of those audits, or at least the tiering system, be made public? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Randall. Are there other questions? No? Sir Craig, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. We cannot simply, because of the sheer scale of the exercise, audit everybody on an annual basis. We've been working through a progression, and we hope to get through everybody, but it can't then all be done on an annual basis. And thereafter, the effect of that, these audits will be monitored by our compliance team. And if there are further steps to be taken, then they will be taken and that will be made public.
Thank you very much, Sir Craig.
If President, if I may, could I just have 2 seconds to finish?
Even three.
There's a clock running here. I would quite like to thank a whole number of people in this room as I prepare to leave my mandate as president of WADA at the end of the year, as this is my last report to you at an IOC session. The last 6 years have contained many challenges, but also much progress. The evidence of major breaches of anti-doping regulations by a major sporting nation has presented a long series of problems to WADA and to international sport. The solutions to these problems over several years have brought sport into an uncomfortable political arena involving extensive media attention and public protest. That WADA and sport have emerged with stronger regulation, better processes, greater competence, and that gives me confidence that the anti-doping system is much better and will be able to deal with such problems if they recur in the future. It has been, in the main, very satisfying to be part of the work undertaken to resolve issues, to improve systems, to increase funding resources, and to lead what is a very significant organisation through this rather difficult period. Dear colleagues, as we begin our second 125 years, can I thank you for being the longest and most steadfast partner of the agency as it strives to defend clean sport. With around at the moment 120 able, effective and committed staff from all around the world, I ask you if you would to continue your support of the organisation and all their efforts to deliver clean sport, to promote the work of WADA, and always to be mindful of the need to protect these most important values that we all hold dear. President, thank you very much.
Thank you, Sir Craig, not only for this report, but thank you very much for all the service you have rendered to clean sport there during your mandate. We will still have the opportunity to honor you then on the occasion of the World Conference in Poland, because we still want you to work for another 6 months, so all the praise is maybe a little bit premature, but we will for sure take the opportunity then to honor what you have done. You said it yourself, it was not the happiest moments in the fight against doping when you were and still are president of WADA, but you have always undertaken great efforts and made then now also great progress in the interest of the protection of clean athletes. And for this, I already thank you now on behalf of the entire IOC session. More to come at the World Conference. Thank you very much and all the best. And now we move on to the independent testing agency. There we have the report by the chair, Madame Fourneron, whom I invite to the stage. Ah, la voilà, elle arrive.
Dear Mr. President, dear Executive Board and IOC members, dear Excellencies and dear colleagues, thank you for your invitation to deliver a brief activity report of the International Testing Agency during such a special week for the IOC and the Olympic movement, with the inauguration of its new home on Olympic Day. Celebrations are in order too for the ITA, as we will be celebrating in a few days ITA's first year anniversary since its launch operations on 1st of July last year. A lot of work has been undertaken over this past year, and it would certainly be too long for me to try and summarize it all today. You will find a one-page summary in your working documents, but let me highlight some of the key points since my last report to the IOC session in Buenos Aires last September. Firstly, I'm pleased to report that the ITA successfully managed the anti-doping program of the 2018 Buenos Aires Youth Olympic Games. The cooperation between the IOC, the ITA, and the organizing committee went very well, and more than 700 samples could be collected. The emphasis of the YOG program was obviously on prevention and education. A similar program will be implemented by the ITA on the occasion of the Lausanne 2020 Winter Youth Olympic Games, and preparatory work is well underway in cooperation with the organizing committee and Anti-Doping Switzerland. In February, the ITA FISU, with the coordination of its anti-doping program for the Winter Universiade in Siberia. The program was delivered smoothly with an obvious emphasis on the education of university students on the dangers of doping. The ITA is now working hard on the preparations for Tokyo 2020. As you know, the ITA will manage the anti-doping program independently from the IOC, and so cooperation is in full swing between ITA and the Tokyo 2020 Organizing Committee to ensure that all logistical, security, and operational aspects are addressed well in advance. As part of the anti-doping program for Tokyo, testing efforts will also focus on the period starting now up until the opening of the Olympic Village, to guarantee that athletes going to the Games will be subject to a proportionate testing program prior to reaching Tokyo. The ITA is coordinating this work with an expert group composed of representatives of summer international federations and national anti-doping organizations. Over this past year, the board that I chair has been able to observe the progress made by the ITA in such a short period in time. I am pleased to report that as the ITA was formed to ensure greater transparency and credibility in global anti-doping efforts, more than 40 international sport organizations, among which 38 international federations, have led the way together with the IOC by reaching a partnership with the ITA and delegating all or part of their anti-doping program. We continue to have to work hard to earn the trust of federations and major events organizers to convince them to embrace the 2016 IOC session's decision to make anti-doping independent from sport organizations. This is not an easy task, and so I am grateful to those that have taken this important step. The cooperation between ITA and WADA, thank you, Mr. Craig, is also extremely positive and allows ITA to support its partners with their compliance with the World Anti-Doping Code. In addition to the six staff of the Doping Free Sport Unit of GAIS, who transferred to the ITA last year, 30 additional anti-doping specialists have been recruited from 17 countries to support our partners and ITA's rapid growth. An Olympian fencer recently joined ITA to deliver anti-doping education to athletes and their entourage, and this is very encouraging. Indeed, promoting the Olympic values of fair play and adopting free sport environment is fundamental. The ITA intends to continue investing in anti-doping education and supporting our partners with tailored education programs and materials, as was the case over the past weeks on the occasion of the International Athlete Forum, the Taekwondo World Championships, and many other international federation events. Increased personal means, increased operating cost, but I'm happy to report that these costs were partly sustained by the revenues generated from the service provided. Thanks as well to a prudent use by the ITA management of the initial Olympic funding, only 30% of the initial Olympic movement contribution for 2018 was used by the ITA to operate. Our objective remains to be able to break even and become truly self-sustainable, and I certainly hope that this can be achieved. In order to give you an idea of the work generated this year, while the doping-free sport unit of GAIS was coordinating approximately 1,500 tests per year, ITA will coordinate this year more than 12,000 tests. When the vast majority of international federations manage disciplinary proceedings for 1 to 5 positive cases per year, the ITA has already managed more than 60 positive cases this year. These volumes assuredly provide ITA with a unique expertise for the benefit of our partners. Finally, ITA is managing on behalf of the IOC the reanalysis program of past editions of the game. In this respect, more than 2,500 samples collected at the 2012 London Olympic Games will have been reanalyzed by the end of this year. All positive cases resulting from this work are brought forward independently by the ITA before the competent jurisdictions. This is a critical piece of work as it allows the IOC to reallocate medals to their rightful owners. As you can see from these few numbers, the ITA is fully committed to becoming the world leader in the delivering of anti-doping programs. We continue to look at innovative ways and technologies to fight doping more efficiently and cost-consciously. We are making every effort to identify the latest available tools to provide our partners confidence that their programs are managed using the most advanced developments in the area of IT security and data protection. Here is a short extract of a recent CNN interview on the ITA highlighting one area we are looking into.
Blockchain is being used to track food, buy real estate, and even in elections. But can it make its way onto the Olympic track? Our story today is on the International Testing Agency in Lausanne, which is teaming up with Block Factory based in Zug.
Finally, we understand the importance for our partners that ITA operates with transparency and regular reporting. We are therefore implementing new fascinating ways to provide them with digital and mobile access to real-time information of their program. In the area of testing, for example, our partners will be able to see at any time the number of tests performed in their sport, in a given region or country, or on a given population of athletes, either by age group or gender or disciplines. For other areas of our work, we are deconstructing complex processes into user-friendly tools for our partners to quickly grasp and use the relevant information. This is an example on therapeutic use exemptions, where you see our internal and quality assurance process, and then the outcome for our partners to use and present to their community. Don't be afraid of any question at the end of the presentation. So This is another example on the athlete biological passport with our internal processes and the dashboard that our partners can use to track activity. There would be a lot of more to present, but as you can see, Mr. President, dear members, the IT board and the IT staff are doing all in their power to build an organization, the Olympic movement, and the international anti-doping community can be proud of. The ITA will hold tomorrow morning its board meeting and will decide, among other items, on the Olympics movement proposal to further underline ITA's independence by adding two additional independent members in our board. This is a positive step for the credibility of our work, and I have no doubt that my board will support it. This, Mr. President, dear colleagues, concludes my report.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Madame Fournereau, for this really encouraging report, which I open for questions now. Obviously, it was so convincing and positive that there are no questions. Congratulations. Thank you very much, and keep going strong with all your team. Thank you. And now, dear friends and colleagues, I propose we move on to point 15 of our agenda. This is the International Council of Arbitration for Sport. And there I invite Mr. Coates to present the report.
Because of the close involvement, Mr. President, of ICAS with the World Anti-Doping Agency, I commence my report by congratulating Sir Craig on his contribution to the fight against doping over the last 6 years, but more particularly the excellent relationship that we've enjoyed with WADA, as the CAS has. Matthew Reeve, are you over there yet? Good. My Secretary General, the Secretary General of CAS, is there. And I also... Minister Banker and Yang Yang, in absence, congratulate you on your elections, if that's the word, and look forward to meeting you, Minister, at the World Congress in Poland, if not before. This report of the CAS activities has been circulated to you, and I'm going to move pretty quickly through it. The looks like we'll continue at the rate of about 600 cases this year. That's what we did last year. We're doing about 50 new cases a month. The case of most interest recently has been the Caster Semenya case, which supported the judgment supported the IAAF rule. It was appealed. There was a stay of proceedings granted, and the full appeal, the award by the Swiss Federal Tribunal, should happen later this year. I mentioned that the Claudia Pechstein is now finished with the Anmuta, the football player. They were denied a further appeal right by the Grand Chamber of the European Court of Human Rights. So that's it there. The only outstanding appeal that she's got remaining is pending is with the German Constitutional Court. And the judgment there is expected within the next 12 months. A new ICAS has been constituted for the period 2019 to 2022, and I mentioned that the Executive Board of the IOC appointed four members, all from outside the IOC membership, Justice Yvonne McCora again, and she was the first, was the former judge of the Constitutional Court of South Africa, appointed by President Mandela. a new member, Judge Patrick Robinson, who's a judge at the International Court of Justice in The Hague, with a background, he's from Jamaica, a background in track and field. Another new one, Dr. Schneiner, Elizabeth Steiner, a former judge at the European Court of Human Rights, and Judge Hangxin Xu of China, who's also a judge at the International Court of Justice in The Hague. Appointments by AINOC, including myself and a recent appointment of David Rivkin of the USA, who was an arbitrator, stepped aside from that and is the immediate past president of the International Bar Association. I think it's a very important, it was a CAS arbitrator appointment. Antonio Aramini from triathlon is probably here. There was a new independent judge also appointed, a current judge at the Swiss Federal Tribunal, Justice Yves Rudy. We've got 20 members, 9 are female, 11 male, so we're trying to do our bit. And 15 were chosen from outside the IOC, AINOC, ASOIF, and the Winter Federations, or are otherwise independent, and I think that's very important for the perception of independence at some of CAS and ICAS. I've been reappointed as president, as had Michael Leonard and Tasha Andre Persenk, vice presidents. And then I can mention that, I should have mentioned, of course, that Tricia Smith continues as a athlete representative. So she and I are the only two from this group. All of the heads of the three divisions now, there's an anti-doping division as well, and the deputies all come from outside the membership of the bodies that appointed them or are otherwise independent. And so they're the body, they're the persons who appoint presidents of panels, and we think that's very, very much reinforces the independence of those panels. We've had just 4 challenges to arbitrators already this year, none were successful. We've had 30 requests for legal aid, 20 were granted in some form or other. We next meet in Budapest in October. There was a roundtable conference last October with representatives, the president of the IOC was there, the other constituent bodies, AINOC, ASOIF, the Winter Federations, GAIF, ITA, WADA, and that had the final input into the establishment of the CAS anti-doping division rules, which came into force from 1st of January. We've appointed 30 to 35 arbitrators experienced in doping matters who can either sit as sole arbitrators in this new division or as presidents of the appeal division. The first sole arbitrations are free, other than the parties pay their own costs, and if they're an individual like an athlete, then there's an opportunity for legal aid and pro bono assistance of a representative. There's a provision now that if the parties agree, you can have a first and final 3-person arbitration under this division, so that you would be waiving your right to appeal to the appeal division of CAS, but of course WADA and the ITA would still retain their right to appeal to the Swiss Federal Tribunal, but I think that's another step forward. In terms of making these procedures cheaper, faster, we've had 2 already completed in less than 7 weeks from filing of the request for arbitration, and they were IOC matters, and there's a 3rd one there, so I think it's going all right. ITU has, and the International Ski Federation have signed to delegate their anti-doping matters to this anti-doping division, including sanctioning, a similar procedure to that which applies during the games themselves, and we're in discussion with, I think, 7 or 8 other summer and winter international federations. I think you've known for some time we've outgrown our premises at the Chateau de Bathurzy, and we have contracted now to buy the part of this, or the southern end of the Palais de Beaulieu, you know, where we used to go for our sessions, and work has commenced there on a total refurbishment and an additional floor that will help us grow in, will cater for our growth into the future. That work will be completed by the last quarter of 2021. That concludes my report, Mr. President. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Coates, for your report. Questions? No? No questions? Happy,
thank you, Mr. President.
Happy day for you. Congratulations.
I was wanting you to tell me whether I was faster or slower than Sir Craig Reedy. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much, Mr. Coates. We now move on to point 17, proposals from members. There the Executive Board hasn't received any. And this gives us the opportunity to go to point 18, there the next meeting. There the Executive Board has an idea to present to you, because we will more or less all meet on the occasion of the Winter Youth Olympic Games in Lausanne. In the beginning of January. There we thought it would be a pity if we would not make use of this occasion, as we did, by the way, there in Buenos Aires on the occasion of the Youth Olympic Games. So that we will call there for a session which will be a lighter session, more about information of what is going on, what is the progress on the implementation of the decision, decisions the session has taken here, and to advise you on further progress and to discuss, of course, any further progress or initiative. Which may be appropriate, so that we are all coming well prepared then to the session in Tokyo 6 months, 7 months, 6 months, 7 months later. What do you think? Did the Executive Board for once have a good idea? Okay, thank you. Then we will call it. It will most likely be the 10th and 11th of January. So, like in Buenos Aires, at the first days of the Youth Olympic Games. And again, we would like to do it more light. I hope we can even accommodate it then in Olympic House. There the working conditions will not be as comfortable as here, but you will have the opportunity to be at home and to have the first ever IOC session then at home in the IOC headquarters. So thank you very much. If you can already take note of these dates, please. And then we come to election time. First election should be the one under 6.1 of the agenda, the re-election of one member of the IOC Ethics Commission. You know from your files that we have proposed one member of the Ethics Commission for re-election. And that we had proposed after consultation with the chair of the Ethics Commission there vacant position to elect Mrs. Fumsile Mlabonuka, who is the former Vice President of South Africa and now the director, Executive Director of UN Women. She is very much looking forward to this, has was honored and pleased to be nominated, but since she is in the as executive director in the UN system, she needs there the formal approval of there the different UN departments in order to be able to accept then or to be proposed for election to the session. So this takes obviously a little bit more time than expected. So the executive board is proposing to you to postpone this election then until the session in January, so that by then she can hopefully have cleared this bureaucratic procedure in the UN system. At the same time, there I would already like to thank the outgoing member, Mr. Kostens, who has rendered great service to the IOC Ethics Commission for many years, is now leaving the commission because the chair and the executive board were considering that the ethics commission should there represent the diversity of the Olympic movement. And since we did not have any member from Africa, there this proposal was made to have Mrs. Fumsile Mlabonuka there to be elected. This has been discussed with Mr. Kostens already a couple of months ago, and I think we owe him the thanks thereof the IOC session for his understanding and for the great work he has been doing. Now, Mr. Carraro, you wanted to applaud before this would be the moment. Thank you very much. You have the biography of Mrs. Patricia O'Brien in your files, so I do not think that we need to go into the details, even less so that it's a re-election. So we can proceed with the vote. And the scrutineers are Mrs. Nicole Hoverts, Mrs. Michaela Kochwango-Jaworski, and Mrs. Kicken Rendell. Never change a winning team. They have performed this task already at the election on the day before yesterday. And having said this, I hand over to the Director General.
Thank you, President. In order for the member of the Ethics Commission to be re-elected, it is necessary that the majority of votes cast are in favor of the election of each candidate. We only have one. For this voting process, the voting possibilities are yes, no, abstain. Please note that for this vote and the following votes taking place this afternoon, the following points will apply. First, abstentions and no votes are not taken into consideration into the calculation of the required majority. Voting by proxy is not allowed. The President elects not to exercise his right to vote. He reserves the right to break a deadlock. Three, all voting members are requested to remain in the room while a vote is open. You will not be eligible to vote should you leave the room while a vote is open. And four, you are not allowed to film or take photos during the votes. You are well aware of all these procedures. We will now proceed with the vote of the member of the IOC Ethics Commission. The result will be announced by the President at the end of the voting procedure. The name and the photo of the candidate will appear on the screen. We shall now proceed with the vote for the re-election of Ms. Patricia O'Brien as member of the IOC Ethics Commission as a personality who is not an active honoree honor or former IOC member. The subject matter of the vote is, do you accept to re-elect Ms. Patricia O'Brien as member of the IOC Ethics Commission as a personality who is not an active honoree honor or former IOC member? Now looking and checking if everyone had received a voting box and a smart card, which seems to be the case, and I will now be requesting the opening of the vote. The vote is open. Did everyone have the possibility to vote? If this is the case, I'm going to declare the vote closed. The vote is closed.
Thank you, Mr. De Keper. Then we move on to 12.5, please, the election of two members of the IOC Executive Board. There are, in fact, two vacations, but the difference is when the vacations become effective. There is one at the end of this session when Mrs. Gunilla Lindberg has to leave the board after 8 years thereof membership in the board. Another one is because Mr. Willy Kaltschmidt, who is reaching the age limit at the end of this year, on 31st of December. He, for reasons of the charter, could still have continued until the next session, which would have been the session in Lausanne. But he wanted to clear there the road then for a new board member to join as soon as possible, because next year is an Olympic year, and that there we could there start this IOC session in Lausanne already with the board, as the board would be then in Tokyo for the Olympic Games, so to have their full consistency. And I think this decision honors very much Mr. Kaltschmidt in this way, you know, really taking the Olympic Games and the athletes first, and not his own person, and not making use of their all the stipulations of the Olympic Charter. Thank you and all our respect for this decision, Mr. Kaltschmidt. So we would start now with the first position, which that's the one which would become vacant now after the end of this session, the ones being vacated by Mrs. Lindberg. Here we have two candidates, His Royal Highness Prince Faisal Al Hussein and Mrs. Nawal El Mutawakkel. The scrutineers are the same as for the other election. Madame Mutawakkel.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Je voudrais réagir par rapport à.
May I just react with regard to what you have just said? I would like to withdraw.
Pour me laisser ma candidature pour le mois de janvier prochain.
And to 2020. Come back with my candidacy in January 2020 in favor of Prince Faisal.
Thank you. Faire l'élection maintenant.
But the election will take place now, nonetheless.
It'll
come into force as of the 1st of January 2020, but the election will be today. Merci, so that'll be for the second round. Thank you, Madame Mutavakel, for this elegant gesture of friendship. Gesture of fair play.
On peut procéder,
this means that we
avec, la vote pour la
then
position,
can proceed with the election for the first position in the executive board
session.
To become valid as of the end of this session. And there we have only one candidate up for election. I'd like to invite the Director General to take the floor. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
I shall declare the vote open for the first position then. The candidates are authorized to vote. I'm asking again if everyone has a voting box and a smart card. You are authorized to vote, Prince Faisal. So the subject matter of the vote is, do you accept that His Royal Highness Prince Faisal Al Hussein be elected as member of the IOC Executive Board? I'm now requesting the opening of the vote. The vote is open. Did everyone have the opportunity to vote? That seems to be the case. Going to declare the vote closed. The vote is closed.
Since the vote is closed, we can proceed with the election for the second position, again, which becomes effective 1st of January 2020. The only candidate is Ms. Nawal El Mutawakel. Mr. Director General.
Thank you, President. In a moment, I shall declare the vote open. The candidates are authorized to vote. Does everyone, I suppose, have a voting box? So the subject matter of the vote is, do you accept that Mrs. Nawal Mutawakel be elected as member of the IOC Executive Board? I'm now requesting the opening of the vote. The vote is open. So did everyone have the opportunity to vote? This seems to be the case. I'm going to declare the vote closed. The vote is closed.
We're waiting one moment, dear friends, so that I can announce the results of these first three votes. And then we will proceed with 12.1. That will be the report of the Members' Election Commission, which will be delivered by our Vice President, Mr. Sai Ching Yu, on behalf of Her Royal Highness, the Princess Royal, who had to leave before. So, Mr. Yu, if you want, you can already move to the lectern while we announce here the results. The first result is about the re-election of Mrs. Patricia O'Brien as a member of the IOC Ethics Commission. Voting cards distributed 67, valid votes 64. Abstentions 3, majority 33, yes 63, no 1. Mrs. Patricia O'Brien is re-elected as member of the IOC Ethics Commission. The election for the Executive Board are showing the following results. First, for the position which becomes vacant after the end of this session, with the only candidate, Prince Faisal. Voting cards distributed 67, valid votes 64, abstentions 3, majority 33, yes 58, no 6. Congratulations, Prince Faisal, and welcome. And welcome to the IOC Executive Board. Please, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. I'd just like to thank the IOC members here in their faith and belief in me to be up as a member of the Executive Board. I will commit myself to continue the work that I've done here and continue to uphold and defend both the rights of equality and equity in the IOC, as well as safe sports. And I look forward to working with you, Mr. President, and the rest of the board for the benefit of the IOC. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The result for the election for the position which becomes vacant as of 1st of January 2020, with the only candidate, Mrs. Nawal El Mutawakkel. Voting cards distributed 67, valid votes 64, abstentions 3, majority 33, yes 57, no 7. Mrs. Nawal El Mutawakkel is elected member of the IOC Executive Board. Congratulations, Mrs. Mutawakkel, and welcome back. And you have the floor.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you to all of you, dear colleagues, for this renewed trust. I also renew my pledge to you, Mr. President, and the Executive Board and all colleagues, my unstinting support of the Olympic movement, which I will serve with love and passion above all, and
merci. And now I give the floor to Mr.
with all my efforts.
Vice President Tsai Ching Yu for the report of the IOC Members Election Commission. Mr. Yu.
Thank you, President, dear colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen. The IOC Members Election Commission met on 16 April 2019. And presented its report to the IOC Executive Board on 22 May 2019. The Commission discussed its activities since its previous meeting and the IOC session in Buenos Aires in 2018. The agenda of the meeting covers the review of candidatures for IOC membership, the extension of the terms of office of the IOC members, the re-election of IOC members after their 8 years term, and the election of IOC honorary members. As of 1st January 2020, these discussions took place in accordance with the new procedure in place as decided by the IOC Executive Board in December 2015. The proposals of the IOC Members Election Commission were put forward to the IOC Executive Board at its meeting on 22 May 2019. The IOC Executive Board approved these proposals and is submitting them to the 134th IOC session for It is decision in Lausanne in June 2019. First extension of terms of office of the IOC members following the approval of recommendation 37 of Olympic Agenda 2020, the age limit for IOC member is set at 70. A one-time term of the office extension for the maximum of 4 years beyond the age limit of 70 can be granted by the IOC session upon the recommendation of the IOC Executive Board. In consultation with the IOC Members Election Commission, in a maximum of 5 cases at a given time, one extension is still active. Mr. Jose Perina, in his capacity as president of the World Games until the end of 2019. The IOC Executive Board is proposing to put forward to the IOC session in June 2019 the name of Mr. Mamadou Diagna Ndiaye, IOC member of Senegal, linked to his function as president of the NOC of Senegal, and age limit to be reached on 31 December 2019 for extension of his age limit due to his eminent position in the government of Senegal and the Senegalese business community, and due to organization of the Youth Olympic Games Dakar 2022. Until the end of 2023, as long as he is the president of the NOC of Senegal. Mr. John Coates, IOC member, Australia, independent individual, and age limit to be reached on 31st December 2020 for extension of his age limit due to his important role as chair of the Legal Affairs Commission until the end of 2024. Professor Uğur Erdener, IOC Vice President, Turkey, independent individual and age limit to be reached on 31 December 2020 for extension of his age limit due to his important role as chair of the Medical and Scientific Commission, and in particular with regard to his important role as representative of the Olympic movement in WADA until the end of 2024. Second, re-election of IOC members. The candidature for re-election of the following IOC member after 8 years of membership was submitted, studied and approved during the meeting of the IOC Members Election Commission. Mr. Gerardo Huertain, Argentina, independent individual, year of birth, 1955. This proposal was then forwarded to the IOC Executive Board and approved during its meeting on 22 May 2019. It will now be submitted to the 134 IOC session for re-election. Third, candidatures for IOC members. All shortlisted the candidatures have been studied and approved by the IOC Members Election Commission and reviewed by the IOC Ethics Commission independent members. The candidatures has been approved by the IOC Executive Board on its meeting on 22 May 2019 and are now being forwarded to the IOC session with a view of election in Lausanne in June 2019. Independent individual by law 2.25 to rule 16. Mrs. Natasha Assembi, Celestine, Audit Ipsen Yangolo from Cameroon, Mrs. Philomena Fetis from Cape Verde, Mrs. Masola Mailoa Hamokup from Lesotho, Mr. Dadijan Tayam from Cote d'Ivoire, Mrs. Launa Chinchilla from Costa Rica, Mr. Eric Thohir from Indonesia, Mr. Spiros Kapulaos from Greece. Candidates are linked to the function within a NOC or World or Continental Association of NOCs by law 2.24 to rule 16. Mr. Mustafa Behaf, as president of the Continental Association, ANOCA, Algeria, Mr. Narendra Dhruv Batra as NOC president, India, Mr. Lee Ki-hyun as NOC president, Republic of Korea. Fourth, proposals for the IOC honorary membership. Mr. Franco Carraro, Italy, Mr. Ivan DeBose, Peru, Mr. Hab Gumel from Nigeria, Mr. William Kashmir from Guatemala, Sami Mujalar from Syria, Austin Sili from Barbados. As President said, Mr. Kashmir announced at the previous IOC Executive Board meeting in March 2019 that as his age limit was due to be reached on 31st December 2019, he had decided that he would step down from the IOC Executive Board on the same day. Ms. Woon Jang, Democratic People's Republic of Korea, Ms. Woon Jang, who could not be present in Buenos Aires, had asked to be present when the decision about his honorary membership was taken. Due to his outstanding services rendered to the Olympic movement, the IOC Executive Board had agreed to put back his election as an IOC honorary member to the IOC session in June 2019. In the meantime, Mr. Zhang cannot be present at the IOC session in June 2019 in Lausanne for health reasons. Nevertheless, he asked to proceed with his appointment at the IOC session in June. The IOC Executive Board approved above list and submits it now to the 134th IOC session in Lausanne in June 2019. Mr. Jose Perurina, elected in 2011, year of birth 1945, Spain, whose term will be ending on the 31st December 2019, has not completed 10 years at the IOC and could therefore not in accordance with the Olympic Charter be put forward to be election as an IOC honorary member. This concludes my report. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Thank you very much, Mr. Yu. Are there questions to the Members' Election Commission? No, so the report was extremely clear. Thank you again, Mr. Yu, and we can now proceed to 12.2 with the election about the extension of mandates. And these, the three colleagues and friends, you have received the names by Mr. Yu. The scrutineers are our winning ladies team. And we could start with the electronic vote for the extension of the age limit of Mr. Mamadou Diagna Ndaye, the Director General.
Thank you, President. So in order for the mandate of an IOC member to be extended, it's necessary that the majority of votes cast are in favor of such an extension. We shall now proceed with the electronic vote for the extension of the age limit of Mr. Mamadou Diagna Ndiaye. I suppose that everyone has his key box and the smart card. This seems to be the case. So the subject matter of the vote is appearing on the screen. I'll let you read it. And I will be now requesting the opening of the vote. The vote is open. Did everyone have the opportunity to vote? This seems to be the case. I'm going to declare the vote closed. The vote is closed.
Thank you, Mr. Director General. Then we could proceed with the vote on the extension of the age limit of Mr. John Coates. Mr. Director General.
So the subject matter of the vote is appearing on the screen. So I'm going to declare
Tompkins.
We have, of course, Mr. Tompkins, did you hand in your smart card before I declare the opening of vote? So I'm now going to request the opening of the vote. The vote is open. Did everyone have the opportunity to vote? This seems to be the case. I'm going to declare the vote closed. The vote is closed.
Thank you, Mr. Director General. And now we will have the vote concerning the extension of the age limit of Mr. Uğur Erdoğan. Mr. Director General.
Yes, Mr. Erdoğan is...
Well, he can vote.
We are returning the smart card to Mr. Tompkins. And Mr. Coates needs his.
He doesn't want to.
Mr. Erdoğan does not want to vote. So I'm waiting that the cards are taken out of the system before opening the vote. So can I ask for the opening of the vote? The vote is open. Did everyone have the opportunity to vote? This seems to be the case. I'm going to declare the vote closed. The vote is now closed.
So we could proceed with 12.3 of our agenda. This is the re-election of Mr. Gerardo Wertheim. You have heard the Members' Election Commission report and the proposal of the IOC Executive Board. So I suggest that we move straight to this vote. Mr. De Keppe.
Just checking that the cards are handed back to Mr. Erdener, that this is the case. So the subject matter of the vote is going to appear on the screen soon. So I'm going to declare the vote open. The vote is now open. Did everyone here have the opportunity to vote? This seems to be the case. I'm going to declare the vote closed. The vote is now closed.
So now I would like to announce to you the results of this round of voting. The extension of the age limit of Mr. Mamadou Dagna Ndaye. Voting cards distributed 65. Valid votes 63. Abstentions 2. Majority 32. Yes 53. No 10. The age limit of Mr. Mamadou Dagna Ndaye is extended until the end of 2023 and as long as he remains president of the National Olympic Committee of Senegal. Congratulations, Mr. Ndaye. You have the floor.
Thank you. All I wanted to say, I'd like to thank you for existing, because otherwise I wouldn't have been re-elected. And thank you very much for the trust you placed in me. Thank you.
Merci, Monsieur Ndaye.
Thank you, Mr. Ndaye.
The result of the extension of the age limit of Mr. John Coates. Voting cards distributed 63. Valid votes 62. Abstentions 1. Majority 32. Yes 52. No 10. The age limit of Mr. John Coates is extended until the end of 2024. Congratulations, Mr. Coates, you have the floor.
Mr. President, dear colleagues, thank you very much for this extension and the opportunity to continue to serve you. I very much appreciate the confidence. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Coates. The result of the vote on the extension of the age limit of Professor Uwe Erdener. Voting cards distributed 64, valid votes 60, abstentions 4, majority 31, yes 47, no 13. The age limit of Professor Uwe Erdener is extended until the end of 2024. Congratulations. Mr. Erdener, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. First of all, I would like to thank all my colleagues and friends concerning their trust, and I will continue to try my best for the IOC, for the Olympic moment. Thank you very much again.
Thank you, Professor Erdener. And now re-election for a period of 8 years of Mr. Gerardo Wertheim. Voting cards distributed 64, valid votes 61, abstentions 3, majority 31, yes 50, no 11. Mr. Gerardo Wertheim is re-elected as IOC member for a period of 8 years. Mr. Wertheim, you have the floor.
Well, thank you very much to all my colleagues for renewing the trust. We will keep working with the passion and thinking of doing good things in the benefit of this beautiful Olympic movement. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Wertheim. And now we proceed to 12.4, please, the election of new IOC members. Again, you have heard there the report of the IOC Members Election Commission, which has, after a review by the IOC Ethics Commission, proposed the names to the IOC Executive Board. The IOC Executive Board then has approved this list of the Members Election Commission and is putting now these names forward to you, the IOC session, for election. We start with the seven candidates proposed as individual members. These are Mrs. Odette Asembe Ngulu, Mrs. Philomena Fortes, Mrs. Matlahong Moila Ramokopo, and Mrs. Laura Chinchilla, as well as Mr. Tijan Tiam, Mr. Eric Tohir, and Mr. Spiros Capralos. And now I hand over to the Director General.
So, thank you, President. In order for a member to be elected, it is necessary that the majority of votes cast are in favor of the election of each candidate. We shall now vote for the first candidate, for Mrs. Odette Asembe Ngulu, Cameroon. You see, the subject matter of the vote is, do you accept to elect Mrs. Odette Asembe Ngulu as a member of the IOC? Does everyone have a voting card? No? I'm asking again, everyone has a voting card now? And it's okay. This seems to be the case. I'm going to declare the vote open. The vote is open. Everyone had the opportunity to vote. This seems to be the case. I'm going to close the vote. The vote is closed.
Thank you, Mr. De Keper. Then we can continue with the vote for Mrs. Filomena Fortes. Mr. De Keper?
You see the subject matter of the vote appearing on the screen. I'm going to declare the vote open. The vote is now open. Did everyone have the opportunity to vote? It seems to be the case. I'm going to declare the vote closed. The vote is now closed.
Thank you. Then we can proceed with the vote for Mrs. Matulang Moilua Ramokopo. Mr. De Keper.
The subject matter is appearing on the screen. I'm going to declare the vote open. The vote is now open. Everyone had the opportunity to vote. This seems to be the case. I'm going to close the vote. The vote is closed.
Thank you, Mr. De Keper. This allows us to continue with the vote for Mr. Tichan Tiam.
The subject matter appears on the screen. I'm going to declare the vote open. The vote is now open. Everyone had the opportunity to vote. That seems to be the case. I'm going to close the vote. The vote is closed.
Thank you. So we can vote now for Mrs. Laura Chinchilla.
Subject matter appears on the screen of the vote. I'm going to declare the vote open. The vote is open. Did everyone have the opportunity to vote? That seems to be the case. I'm going to close the vote. The vote is now closed.
Thank you, Mr. De Keper. So we proceed with the vote for Mr. Eric Tohir.
So the subject matter of the vote is appearing on the screen. I'm going to declare the vote open. The vote is open. Did everyone have the opportunity to vote? It appears so. Going to declare the vote closed. The vote is closed.
Then we continue, please, with the vote for Mr. Spiros Capralos.
The subject matter appears on the screen. I'm going to declare the vote open. The vote is open. Did everyone have the opportunity to vote? This seems to be the case. I'm going to close the vote. The vote is closed, and I will ask Mrs. Uvers to bring the results to the president now.
Dear friends and colleagues, I can now announce the results on the elections of individual members of the IOC. Mrs. Odette Asembe Ngulu, voting cards distributed 65, valid votes 63, abstentions 2, majority 32, yes 51, no 12. Madame Odette Asembe Ngulu est élue membre du Comité international olympique. Félicitations.
Congratulations, you have been elected as member of the IOC, madam.
Mrs. Filomena Fortes. Voting cards distributed 65. Valid votes 64. Abstentions 1. Majority 33. Yes 56. No 8. Mrs. Filomena Fortes is elected member of the International Olympic Committee. Congratulations. Mrs. Matluhang Moilua Ramokopo. Voting cards distributed 65. Valid votes 65. Majority 3. Yes 52. No 13. Mrs. Matluhang Moilua Ramokopo is elected member of the International Olympic Committee. Congratulations. Monsieur Tichan Tiam.
Mr. Tichan Tiam.
It's 65. Valid votes 64. Abstentions 1. Majority 33. Yes 59. No 5, Monsieur Tichan Tiam.
Monsieur Tichan Tiam,
élu membre du comité international,
has been elected member of the International Olympic Committee. Congratulations.
Mrs. Laura Chinchilla. Voting cards distributed 65. Valid votes 61. Abstentions 4. Majority 31. Yes 55. No 6. Mrs. Laura Chinchilla is elected member of the International Olympic Committee. Congratulations. Mr. Eric Trujillo. Voting cards distributed 65. Valid votes 63. Abstentions 2. Majority 32. Yes 55. No 8. Mr. Eric Trujillo is elected member of the International Olympic Committee. Congratulations. Mr. Spiros Kapralos. Voting cards distributed 65. Valid votes 64. Abstentions 1. Majority 33. Yes 60. No 4. Mr. Spiros Kapralos is elected member of the International Olympic Committee. Congratulations. The members will take the oath later on, and then they will also be introduced, of course, to all the new colleagues. In the meantime, we continue with the election of candidates representing an NOC or a continental association of NOCs. These candidates are Mr. Mustafa Beraf in his capacity as president of ANOCA, Mr. Narinder Dhruv Batra in his capacity as president of the NOC of India, and Mr. Ki Hyun Lee in his capacity as president of the NOC of the Republic of Korea. Mr. De Keppa.
Thank you, President. We will now vote for Mr. Mustafa Beraf. Subject matter of the vote is appearing on the screen. I'm asking if everyone is still have voting keypad in the smart card, which seems to be the case. I'm going to declare the opening of the vote. The vote is now open. Did everyone have the opportunity to vote? This seems to be the case. I'm closing the vote now.
Thank you, Mr. De Keppa. So we can proceed with the vote for Mr. Narinder Dhruv Batra.
Subject matter of the vote is appearing on the screen. We have one incompatibility. This is Ms. Nita Imbani, who will render a smart card. We will take the card out of the system before opening the vote. Quick, Alice. Can I open the vote now? The vote is open. Did everyone have the opportunity to vote? Seems to be the case. I'm going to close the vote. Vote is closed.
Thank you, Mr. De Keppa. So we can go to the vote for Mr. Ki Hung Lee. Mr. De Keppa.
Yes, and in the meantime, we render the smart card to Mrs. Ambani. And we take the smart card of Mr. Seung Min Ryu. He's impeached for this vote. Been done. We're taking the cards out of the system. It's done, so I'm going to open the vote. The vote is now open. Did everyone vote? This seems to be the case. I'm going to close the vote. The vote is closed.
So I suggest to wait there until we have got the results also for these three candidates, and then we would continue with the election of honorary members according to 12.6 of our agenda.
last ones.
Thank you, Mrs. Horvats, and thank you already to you and the scrutineers for your work. But wait a moment, if somebody should request a secret vote on the honorary members, we may still need you. Mr. Mustafa Beraf, voting cards distributed 65, valid votes 63, abstentions 2, majority 32, yes 56, no 7. Mr. Mustafa Beraf, elected member of the International Olympic Committee. Mr. Narinder Dhruv Batra, voting cards distributed 64, valid votes 62, abstentions 2, majority 32, yes 58, no 4. Mr. Batra is elected member of the International Olympic Committee. Mr. Ki Yung Lee, voting cards distributed 64, valid votes 62, abstentions 2, majority 32, yes 57, no 5. Mr. Ki Yung Lee is elected member of the International Olympic Committee. Congratulations. So, again, thank you there, Mrs. Horvats, Mrs. Kochanga-Jaworski, and Mrs. Randall, for your work, which is safeguarding there the integrity of our elections. We come to 12.6, honorary members. Here as well, you have heard the report of the Members' Election Commission. This report has been approved by the IOC Executive Board and also there the individual names. Therefore, I suggest that we proceed right away with a vote and that following our tradition, we do this by showing hands. The first is Mr. Ung Chang. He can unfortunately not be with us here today, but he asked to proceed with his election. I think you all know him and about his great merits for his country, the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, but also his great merits for the International Olympic Committee and the entire Olympic movement. May I therefore suggest to elect him as IOC honorary member. Is raise your hands there with the applause. I cannot see the level of support. So thank you. Any against? No. Any abstentions? No. Thank you very much. Mr. Ung Chang is elected honorary member. Mr. Franco Carraro, Italy. I don't think that I have to say much. And we will anyway then say a farewell and honor these members once we present them with the Olympic Order on the occasion of the next IOC session. Because as you know, active IOC members cannot receive Olympic orders. They will receive the Olympic order only after their retirement is effective. And on this occasion, then we will pay tribute to their great achievements then again. So please allow me just to use the short version today. And the short version of Mr. Carraro, I think you were witness here in these 2 days about how he mastered there, in particular, this very difficult and very important position of chairing the IOC Program Commission. At, under his leadership, we managed to have the biggest reform of the Olympic program for decades, at least. And we also managed by an unanimous vote the reform of the Olympic program for Paris 2024. And these are only his latest achievements. There are many, many before. And I can add also on a personal note that I, as a young IOC member, I was benefiting a lot from his great advice, from his friendship and encouragement, and could experience over the years his mastership, how to deal with a difficult situation and to come to good solutions and finding majorities for good solutions. So I propose to elect Mr. Franco Carraro as honorary member of the International Olympic Committee. Who agrees, please raise your hand. Thank you. Any opposition? No. Any abstentions? No. Congratulations, Mr. Carraro. Mr. Ivan Dibos, you know him and you remember him very well, just from the many tasks he had in the recent years, not the least there hosting as IOC member in Peru the Olympism in Action Forum and the historic session in Lima. And these under circumstances which were very difficult at the time in the country, and there were even times when we were considering whether we could go to Lima after the natural catastrophe which was hitting his country, but where he was always steering in the right and straightforward way and encouraging the IOC Executive Board to come to Peru and to show our solidarity with the Peruvian people. I propose Mr. Ivan Dibos for election as honorary member of the International Olympic Committee. Who is in favor? Please raise your hand. Any noes? Any abstentions? Congratulations, Mr. Dibos. Mr. Abu Ghumel, he is an IOC member since 2009. And also he has a lot of merits for the Olympic movement in his country, but also worldwide. Here I would only like there to remember the situation about the election of the host of the Youth Olympic Games in Africa, when Nigeria was very much interested in hosting these Youth Olympic Games. But where Mr. Ghumel then was a key that could be considered as youth Olympic Games, not just being held in one country, but being held in Africa, and supporting then the candidature of Dakar, Senegal, and in this way making sure that Africa could be united. This was a great gesture of fairness and of friendship and of African solidarity. Therefore, I propose to elect Mr. Gumel as IOC honorary member. Who is in favor? Please raise your hand. Thank you. Any noes? No. Any abstentions? No. Mr. Gumel, congratulations. Mr. Willy Kaltschmidt, IOC members since 1988. Many, many merits, and still very, very active. Maybe just to highlight one or two. He was the organizer of a brilliant IOC session in his hometown, Guatemala City. He was and is still serving of the IOC executive board as a very active member in the IOC executive board. He is now also a member of the task force, which will manage the challenge we have there on the table with regard to boxing, and in particular there with refereeing in boxing. And just a couple of minutes ago, he showed again his dedication to the Olympic values by declaring his resignation even before the end of his term as IOC executive board member. Therefore, I propose Mr. Willy Kaltschmidt as a member, honorary member of the IOC. In favor? Thank you. No. Abstention? Congratulations, Mr. Kaltschmidt. Mr. Sami Mudalal from Syria, IOC member since 1998, and being always a very active IOC member, and having had to address many, many challenges in particular in his home country in Syria. We all know about the fate of the Syrian people, and how difficult it is under these circumstances of a civil war to maintain the values of sport, to keep an Olympic team alive in the country. And there, Mr. Mudalal has great merits for his country, but also for the IOC. And therefore, I propose him as IOC honorary member. In favor? Thank you. Noes? No. Abstentions? No. Congratulations, Mr. Mudalal. Mr. Austin Seeley, an IOC member since 1994, always active, always defending the rights of sport and the athletes, in particular in his region, which during the years of his membership in the IOC became more and more successful in the Olympic Games, and this is also greatly thanks to his great engagement, not only in his country, but in his region. Therefore, I propose Mr. Austin Seely to be elected honorary member of the IOC. In favor? Thank you. No. Abstentions? No. Congratulations, Mr. Seely, for your election. And now I would like to invite Mr. Carraro and Mr. Dibos, Mr. Gumel, Mr. Kaltschmidt, Mr. Sami Mudalal, Mr. Austin Seely, and the son of Mr. Ung Chang, but also Mr. Perurina, who will also be leaving the IOC on 31st of December on 2019, to join me here on the stage, because I would at least hand over a small token of appreciation to them.
I know.
And now I would like to give the floor to Mrs. Gunilla Lindbeck.
Thank you, President. As you informed earlier, I'm now finishing my 8 years term in the Executive Board. I can tell you all these 8 years have been a great honor and pleasure to work in our board, and I want to thank you, Mr. President, for all the support and for all the new ideas that you have brought to the table. And I'm especially happy to have been a part of the discussions of the new norm and the Olympic Agenda 2020. It feels like a period that will be remembered for the future. I also had the great honor to share the Pyeongchang Coordination Commission, which was also a very special journey for me. Ups and downs, and good friends, and a fantastic cooperation with my Korean friends. So that has also been very special. You also have let me work in many commissions with Mr. Carraro, with the Program Commission, Olympic Solidarity, and I don't remember now for the Paris, but this whole 8 years has, it's never been boring. It's been new challenges, almost every meeting, full of discussions, and I will miss it. Of course, you will miss the work. I think, though, I need some rest, at least for 1 year. And I'm very happy, and I want to congratulate His Highness Prince Faisal to take my seat on the board. And I know he will also fight for the gender equity, and he will do a good job. Also want to congratulate my colleague Naval. We have been together in the board for many years, and I know she will do a great job. So to all my friends up here, thank you very much for good cooperation. And as I said, thank you, President, for all the exciting time it has been for me. And I wish you good luck with the coming years as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mrs. Lindbeck. I could add many, many more merits there you have achieved during your time in the executive board. But I think maybe knowing you a little bit, it means even more to you when we tell you once more how much we all appreciated working with you, what a great team member you always were, and that we will greatly miss you and your contribution to the IOC Executive Board. But don't worry, we will keep watching you, because you do not leave the IOC, but just the Executive Board. So thank you from the bottom of our hearts again. And I would also like to present to you a small token of our appreciation and gratefulness. And now, dear friends and colleagues, I propose that we move on to point 16 of our agenda. This is Olympic orders. You know that the Olympic order is the highest honor granted by the IOC to individuals who have rendered outstanding services to the Olympic cause through their contribution to the development of sport. You also know that we are awarding Olympic orders posthumously only by one exception, and that is if a member of the IOC is dying during his term of office. And therefore, I would like to acknowledge here in the room the presence of the wife of our late friend and colleague, Patrick Baumann, Patricia Baumann. Welcome to the IOC session, Mrs. Baumann. All are still with you in our thoughts and with your family. A very warm welcome to the IOC session. We also welcome their two children, Bianca and Paul, who will then accept the Olympic order for her father, for their father. And I would like also to acknowledge the president, the wife of our late colleague and friend, Nettie Indrapana, Mrs. Didi Indrapana, who is also here with us today. And now I ask our Chief of Protocol for the IOC members, Mr. Willy Kaltschmidt, to proceed with the award ceremony for Olympic orders. Mr. Kaltschmidt.
Dear President, dear colleagues and friends, last year, two of our dear colleagues have left us. Patrick Baumann and Nat Indrapana. Both were true gentlemen of a sport surrounded by many friends around the world. They have greatly contributed to the Olympic movement and the promotion of Olympic values. We will award the Olympic Order posthumously. It has been our honor and privilege to serve alongside them. As we pay tribute to their lives today, may I invite Bianca and Paul Baumann to join me on this day to receive the Olympic Order for their father, Patrick. Thank you. Patrick Baumann will forever be remembered as a true fan of sport, a great sport leader, admired and respected by everyone. As a former player, coach, and referee, and FIFA Secretary General, he dedicated his life to basketball and the sports community. Within the IOC, he had actively participated in its development, chairing several commissions. He was a fervent advocate and defender of our movement, aware of what sport can do for people, in particular for the young generations and for the world. The IOC president will now present the Olympic order to Bianca and Paul, the children of our dear friend Patrick Bauman. May I now invite Didi Indrapana, the wife of the late Nat Indrapana, and his daughter Nikki, to join me on the stage to receive the Olympic order for Nat Indrapana. Nat Indrapana was a key figure in the development of sport in Thailand and Asia. He dedicated his whole life for sport, holding numerous positions with sport organizations like the NOC of Thailand, the Olympic Council of Asia, the World Taekwondo Federation, just to name a few. He played an active role on many IOC commissions, following closely, for example, the organization of Olympic Games by sitting on several coordination commissions. Nat Indrapana will be remembered as a true advocate of the value of sports in our movement. The IOC president will now present the order to Didi Indrapana and her daughter Nikki. We are now recognizing our IOC colleague who has been by our side promoting our Olympic movement for so many years. Today, as an IOC honorary member, he continues to allow us to benefit from his long-standing experience, expertise, and commitment to the service of sports and the Olympic movement. I am pleased to call to the stage our dear colleague, Mr. Sam Ransami. Throughout his life, Sam Ransami has always believed in the power of sport to change the world. We all remember his fight for building a sport without barriers in his country, South Africa. He played a key role in the readmission of the South African Olympic Committee to the Olympic fold after 28 years of absence. Within the IOC, he has brought all his know-how and sport leadership experience to bear within several commissions, including the executive board. Still today, he strongly defends and promotes the right of sport for all, the right for bringing sports to everyone, everywhere. Sam Ramsamy, in recognition of your outstanding merit in the cause of the world of sport and your faithfulness to the Olympic idea as illustrated by Pierre de Coubertin, renovated of the Olympic Games, the IOC president will award you the Olympic Order. Over many years, we were fortunate to have them at our side, witnessing their strong commitment, dedication, and enthusiasm. Today, even if they left the IOC, they continue to be remarkable ambassadors of the Olympic values and our movement. I'm now pleased to call to the stage Mr. Barry Meister. An Olympic gold medalist in hockey and three times Olympian, Barry Meister is today one of the New Zealand's most recognized sports administrators. He has contributed significantly to the development of the sport in his country and across Oceania, holding various positions with the NOC of New Zealand, the ONOC and ANOC. For 8 years, his experience as an athlete and sports leader has benefited the IOC and the commission of which he sits. A teacher by profession, Barry Meister has always been a firm believer in sports' ability to educate. Mr. Barry Meister, in recognition of your outstanding merit in the cause of world sport and your faithfulness to the Olympic idea as illustrated by Pierre de Coubertin, renovator of the Olympic Games, the IOC president will award you the Olympic Order. I'm now pleased to call to the stage Mr. Richard Peterkin. All of us in the Olympic movement have been privileged to witness Richard Peterkin's strong dedication and commitment to our values. He actively took part in the development of sport in his country, being the first president of the St. Lucia Olympic Committee. He also joined the Commonwealth Games, Pan Am Sports, and ANOC. He also made a significant contribution to our movement in the areas of good governance and financing by sitting on the Olympic Solidarity and other IOC commissions. Mr. Richard Peterkin, in recognition for your standing merit in the cause of world sport and your faithfulness to the Olympic idea as illustrated by Pierre de Coubertin, renovator of the Olympic Games, the IOC president will award you the Olympic Order. Dear colleagues, we are now honoring a sporting personality who has shown throughout his life an outstanding commitment to sport and its values, as well as to the community. It is my pleasure to ask Mr. Ruperto Nicolás Herrera to join me on the stage. An outstanding basketball player and a bronze Olympic medalist, Mr. Ruperto Nicolás Herrera took part in four consecutive editions of Olympic Games, Mexico 68, Munich 72, Montreal 76, and Moscow 80. After leaving the court, he placed his knowledge and experience at the service of the sport on national and international level, holding many positions such as Cuban Basketball Federation president, FIBA Central Board member, and still today as Secretary General of the Cuban Olympic Committee. Mr. Ruperto Nicolás Herrera, in recognition of your outstanding merits in the cause of the world of sport and your faithfulness to the Olympic idea as illustrated by Pierre de Coubertin, renovator of the Olympic Games, the IOC President, we award you with the Olympic Order. Thank you. Congratulations to all.
Dear friends and colleagues, Mr. Kaltschmidt, you should
stay there,
please. We will now, having the newly elected members taking the oath.
Dear colleagues, would you please raise for the Olympic anthem? And please remain standing during the oath taking ceremony. Thank you so much for that. The Olympic anthem, please. Now I will call Ms. Odette Asembe Ngolu. Please come to the lectern. English or French?
Admise.
Granted the honour of becoming a member of the International Olympic Committee and declaring myself aware of my responsibilities in such a capacity, I undertake to serve the Olympic movement to the very best of my ability, to respect and ensure the respect of all the provisions of the Olympic Charter and the decisions of the International Olympic Committee, which I consider as not subject to appeal on my part, and to comply with the code of ethics, to keep myself free from any political or commercial influence and from any racial or religious consideration, to fight against all forms of discrimination, and to promote in all circumstances the interests of the International Olympic Committee and those of the Olympic movement.
Ms. Filomena Forte, please come to the lectern.
Granted the honor of becoming a member of International Olympic Committee and declaring myself aware of my responsibilities in such capacity, I undertake to serve the Olympic movement to the very best of my ability, to respect and ensure the respect of all the provisions of the Olympic charters and decisions of the International Olympic Committee, which I consider as not subject to appeal of my part, to comply with the code of ethics, to keep myself free from any political or commercial influence, and from any political or commercial influence, and from any racial or religious consideration, to fight against all other forms of discrimination, and to promote in all circumstances the interest of the International Olympic Committee and those of the Olympic movement. Thank you.
Ms. Matluhan Muloa Ramakopu, would you please come to the lectern?
Granted the honor of becoming a member of the International Olympic Committee and declaring myself aware of my responsibilities in such capacity, I undertake to serve the Olympic movement to the very best of my ability, to respect and ensure the respects of all provisions of the Olympic Charter and the decisions of the International Olympic Committee, which I consider as not subject to appeal on my part, to comply with the code of ethics, to keep myself free from any political and commercial influence and from any racial or religious consideration, to fight against all other forms of discrimination and to promote in all circumstances the interests of the Olympic, of the International Olympic Committee and those of the Olympic movement. Thank you.
Now, may I ask Mr. Tijian Tian, please come to the lectern.
admis l'honneur de faire partie du comité.
Granted the honor of being a member, becoming a member of the International Committee, and declaring myself aware of my responsibilities in such a capacity, I undertake to serve the Olympic movement to the very best of my ability, to respect and ensure the respect of all the provisions of the Olympic Charter and the decisions of the International Olympic Committee, which I consider as not subject to appeal on my part, and to comply with the Code of Ethics, to keep myself free from any political or commercial influence, and from any racial or religious consideration, to fight against all other forms of discrimination, and to promote in all circumstances the interests of the International Olympic Committee and those of the Olympic movement.
Your Excellency, Ms. Laura Chinchilla, will you please come to the lectern?
Granted the honor of becoming a member of the International Olympic Committee and declaring myself aware of my responsibilities in such capacity, I undertake to serve the Olympic movement to the very best of my ability, to respect and ensure the respect of all the provisions of the Olympic Charter and the decisions of the International Olympic Committee, which I consider as not subject to appeal on my part, to comply with the Code of Ethics, to keep myself free from any political or commercial influence or from any racial or religious consideration, to fight against all other forms of discrimination, and to promote in all circumstances the interest of the International Olympic Committee and those of the Olympic movement.
Now, Mr. Eric Toyer, will you please come to the lectern?
Granted to the honor of becoming a member of International Olympic Committee and declaring myself aware of my responsibilities in such capacity, I undertake to serve the Olympic movement to the very best of my ability, to respect and ensure the respect of all provisions of the Olympic Charter and the decision of the International Olympic Committee, which I consider as not subject to appeal on my part, to comply with the Code of Ethics, to keep myself free from any political or commercial influence and from any racial or religious consideration, to fight against all other forms of discrimination, and to promote in all circumstances the interests of the International Olympic Committee and those of the Olympic movement.
Now, Mr. Spiros Kapralos, please come to the lectern.
fly.
Granted the honor of becoming a member of the International Olympic Committee and declaring myself aware of my responsibilities in such capacity, I undertake to serve the Olympic movement to the very best of my ability. To respect and ensure the respect of all the provisions of the Olympic Charter and the decisions of the International Olympic Committee, which I consider as not subject to appeal on my part. To comply with the Code of Ethics. To keep myself free from any political or commercial influence and from any racial or religious consideration. To fight against all other forms of discrimination and to promote in all circumstances the interests of the International Olympic Committee and those of the Olympic movement.
Mr. Mustafa Berat, please come to the lectern, please.
Granted the honor of becoming a member of the International Olympic Committee and declaring myself aware of my responsibilities in such capacity, I undertake to serve the Olympic movement to the very best of my ability to respect and ensure the respect of all the provisions of the Olympic Charter and the decisions of the International Olympic Committee, which I consider as not subject to appeal on my part, to comply with the Code of Ethics, to keep myself free from any political or commercial influence, and from any racial or religious consideration, to fight against all forms of discrimination, and to promote in all circumstances the interests of the International Olympic Committee and those of the Olympic movement.
May I call now Mr. Narinder Dhruv Batra, please come to the lectern.
Granted the honor of becoming a member of the International Olympic Committee and declaring myself aware of my responsibilities in such capacity, I undertake to serve the Olympic movement to the very best of my ability, to ensure the respect of all the provisions of the Olympic Charter and the decisions of the International Olympic Committee, which I consider as not subject to appeal on my part, to comply with the Code of Ethics, to keep myself free from any political or commercial influence and from any racial or religious consideration, to fight against all other forms of discrimination and to promote in all circumstances the interests of International Olympic Committee and those of the Olympic movement. Thank you.
Mr. Ki Hong Lee, please come to the lectern.
Granted the honor of becoming a member of the International Olympic Committee and declaring myself aware of my responsibility in such capacity, I undertake to serve the Olympic movement to the very best of my ability to respect and ensure the respect of all the provisions of the Olympic Charter and the decisions of the International Olympic Committee, which I consider as a subject to appeal on my part to comply with the Code of Ethics, to keep myself free from any political or commercial influence, and from any racial or religious consideration, and from any racial to fight against all other forms of discrimination and to promote in all circumstances the interests of the International Olympic Committee and those of the Olympic movement.
Thank you.
To all our members here, of course, I would like to ask you not to exit the rooms. We still have, after the greetings of our new members, we still have the speech of our dean. So please remain in the room.
Ladies and gentlemen, please be reminded, this is not yet the end of the session. Please stay with us in the room, and dear IOC members, please be so kind and go back to your seats. Thank you.
Marcus.
Thank you.
Mesdames et messieurs, chers membres du CEO, ce n'est pas encore la fin de la session. Nous vous prions de regagner vos sièges, s'il vous plaît. Merci.
Dear friends and colleagues, we are about to finish our agenda there, and let's please move to point 19 of our agenda. This is miscellaneous. Are there any questions, comments to be made? No, then I would like to ask our Dean, Mr. Pound, to deliver the traditional final speech of the IOC session. Mr. Pound.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's my privilege as doyen on behalf of all of our colleagues to thank you as President for a very successful management of our session. I think particular congratulations are due, in addition to getting through a considerable amount of regular business, on the following items. First, and I'll lump this in with the session, is the official opening of Olympic House on Olympic Day, showcasing a splendid example of design and sustainability. Secondly, the completion of the process for selecting the host city for the 2026 Olympic Winter Games. And my only comment on that is that we in future, if we go through this process, we've got to make sure that everybody is on the same page in terms of what they think has happened. That includes management and the candidates and everybody else. Third, providing an opportunity to draw attention of the members and a wider audience to the environmental tsunami that is approaching us, and I hope you will pass on our congratulations to Madame Figueres for a very lively and accessible speech and treatment and dealing with the questions that came out of it. Fourth, the resolution to date, at least, of the difficult situation involving AIBA, but what's important in that out of this session is that our actions are consistent with our principles, and that is, I think, a message not only for AIBA but probably a wider audience as well. Fifth, the wind-up of one successful organizing committee and progress reports on six others that are in the stream. Sixth, the welcoming of 10 new members of the new colleagues. They're coming in at a particularly important and interesting time in the history of the Olympic movement, and I hope they will enjoy their entry into the IOC as much as all of us have. Seventh, the confirmation of our refugee teams in Tokyo 2020. Which provides, on the one hand, an opportunity for a certain number of refugees, but also exposure on a worldwide platform of the wider issues affecting refugees in the world today. Eighth, the evolution of the process for selecting our hosts and the adjustments needed to meet some of the new realities that we're encountering as time progresses. It is a work in progress, and we all know what it will involve as we get better at doing it. But I think it's been a great start, and it will. This session will be remembered for that. Ninth, amongst the other charter changes that we made is one that responds directly and concretely to an issue that has been brought to our attention by athletes. And I think that that is a demonstration of some of our concerns about making sure that athletes are the center of our movement. And finally, the confirmation of yet another occasion to go back to our roots in 2021 to visit Greece, a session that will start on Olympic Day, appropriately enough, and followed by a real return to the roots in a trip to Olympia. So it's been a very busy session. You managed the time well, notwithstanding refusal of some of our members to keep things to a minimum. And it's just a sign that I should start working on my notes for January of next year. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Pound, for your kind words, which I think the applause shows has been appreciated by all our fellow IOC colleagues and friends. I would like to thank the Director General and the administration, our interpreters, and all the support staff, the many who have been working in front and behind the curtain to make this 134th IOC session such a great success. Thank you on behalf of the IOC session to all of you. And then I would like to thank you, my dear friends and colleagues, for an extremely constructive IOC session with many decisions, with many good discussions, and with many good decisions also. Yesterday, in my speech, I made a reference to Pierre de Coubertin different times. Today, after this session, I know for sure that at least today, he is very proud of us. Because I would like to remind you of one quote there. He said, "Independent and united, we have faith in ourselves." And this was the spirit of this session. Independent, united, and with faith in ourselves and faith in the future. Thank you very much. The 134th IOC session, Lausanne Olympic Capital, is closed.
Dear members, please join us on the stairs for the official photo. Thank you.